So we're going to try to answer several questions here. Could the climate be changing? Is it possible that humans really could be making the climate change? Is it changing? If it's changing, why? Should we care about that? And if we do care, what can we do about it? I'd like to start with this one. These are my granddaughters confronting the ocean. And the ocean, it may perhaps is analogous in a way, what we face in confronting climate change. It's clearly something that's big and that we don't really understand totally. And the ocean is also very important in climate change. So we'll come back to the ocean. It's been known for a long time that the Earth is kept warm by carbon dioxide. Without the greenhouse effect, the planet would be much colder. And as early as 1827, this was filtering into awareness. Joseph Fourier, I guess it's how you pronounce, who some of you, if you have some physics background, know about, was the one who basically coined the term greenhouse gas. He likened the atmosphere to a glass house or a greenhouse. Later, in the 1800s, John Tyndall, who was an Irish physicist and mountain climber, and he was a many talented fellow, but started looking at the infrared absorbance capabilities of gases, the ability of gases to absorb those rays that we can't really see, but which carry heat. When you're standing in front of a hot stove, you're feeling the energy that is in infrared rays. And Tyndall was able to measure how much infrared carbon dioxide and other gases absorbed. And later on, that was began to be clear to people that this is really what was going on with the atmosphere. I like to describe it in sort of an analogous way to what happens when you get in your car that's been sitting in the sun. You notice how much warmer it is. And what happens, and it's an analogy with the atmosphere, it's not a one-to-one correspondence, but the light rays come in through the glass. They're absorbed by the upholstery and the dashboard, et cetera, and that energy is re-radiated as infrared, which does not get through glass. So the interior warms up. The Earth's atmosphere behaves in an analogous way, where carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases allow visible light through, and that visible light carries energy, warms up the surface of the Earth, and the rays that re-radiate from the Earth don't all escape into space as efficiently as they came through from space. So the temperature of the Earth builds up. In 1896, Svante Arrhenius, who those of you who are somewhat familiar with temperature will also recognize, he took a shot at calculating how much colder the Earth would be if it had half as much carbon dioxide. And then, at the urging of some colleagues, said, okay, what would happen if we doubled the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere? How much warmer would the Earth be? He estimated that the Earth would be about 5 degrees centigrade warmer than it currently is, or was at that time, is, because it's pretty close to what it was then. And interestingly, that number is not too far from what the latest models suggest. But it was clear at that point that carbon dioxide was important and could be a player in the Earth's climate. We probably needed to get a better handle on how much carbon dioxide really was in the atmosphere. And how many people remember Ike, President Eisenhower? Okay, I had a fifth grade teacher who loved Ike. And we heard all about Ike. But one of the things that we heard about was one of the projects that President Eisenhower strongly supported, which was the International Geophysical Year. That was 1956. And it was a year in which the idea of studying geophysics of the Earth came to the fore. And one of the proposals put forward by David Keeling, who was at that time a newly minted Ph.D., was to measure carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And Keeling managed to get funding and established an observatory in Mauna Loa. It's interesting to think of why would he pick such a remote spot as the top of a mountain way out in the Pacific. But upon reflection, it's a good choice because that's a good place to get background average CO2 concentrations. So Keeling set up that laboratory. This is a picture of it. It's about 10,000 feet, very different from the lush greenery below, but it's a good spot to measure background concentrations of gases. And the data started coming in, this is what we see. This is known as the Keeling curve, and some say it's becoming the most famous graph in the world. I don't know how famous graphs get to be, but this one's getting up there. And what it is showing us is a couple interesting things. One is that there's a yearly pulse in carbon dioxide. It's been likened to a track of the Earth's breathing. This is a pulse that where the CO2 levels drop during the course of the spring and summer, and then reach a low point right around October, and then they build up again. And that's because of plants. Most of the world's plants are in the northern hemisphere, and when we have the northern hemisphere spring, photosynthesis begins, and that carbon dioxide that's really, in a sense, a food for plants is pulled out of the air. And then when the plants lose their leaves and those leaves degrade and turn back into CO2 in the fall, the levels rise again. Every year, they rise a little more. And we now have CO2 concentrations about 400 parts per million, which is about 40% higher than they have been for millions of years. So it is different out there, especially so probably to plants. But we'll talk more about what that difference could mean. One of the things that often is mentioned about that is, well, how do we know that's human caused? There have been fluctuations of all sorts in the past. Well, it's virtually certain, and I guess I would say 99.999% certain that this is anthropogenic, this rise. One of the ways we know that is by looking at the isotope ratio of carbon. Carbon, the atom, has several different isotopes, and an isotope is a atom that weighs more or less than other atoms of its ilk. And in the case of carbon, we have carbon atoms that have 12 atomic mass units, and we have some that have 13 and some that have 14. It turns out that most of them are 12. There's a very small percentage that are carbon 13, very tiny that are carbon 14. Plants preferentially take up carbon 12. Because it's lighter. It can filter in through the stomata of their leaves better. We've noticed that during the course of the last 50 years, the ratio of carbon 12 to carbon 13 has been changing in the atmosphere. There's more carbon 12 than there used to be. That says that the carbon that's been added to the atmosphere is coming from plant matter, which includes fossil fuels. Fossil fuels came from plants. And it also comes from burning of forests. So that's one reason to believe this is anthropogenic. The second one is we know how much coal, oil, gas has been burned within pretty good limits because these things have been bought and sold. And there's a record of how much coal has been burned. And when you look at all the fossil fuels that have been consumed, the amount that's in the atmosphere is about half that much. But clearly the combustion of fossil fuels can account for this CO2. So there's two strong pieces of evidence that it's anthropogenic. And the third is that the rise has been very rapid in geological terms and coincident with the Industrial Revolution. Going back farther in time is a little tougher. We've only had Keeling's curve for 50 years. Ice cores provide a way. Pores of gas that are trapped in ice have been analyzed and looked at, and the carbon dioxide content can be determined. And when we do that, we can go back in time, and the first ice cores that were looked at took us back about 1,000 years, and we can see that carbon dioxide was fairly constant until the last 50 years or so. When we go farther back in time, again with ice cores, well, let me just digress a minute. We also can look at other gases, and these are other greenhouse gases that should not be ignored. The top one is carbon dioxide, the middle is methane, and the bottom one is nitrous oxide. All of these are greenhouse gases, the second two more potent than carbon dioxide, all show the same rapid increase on geological timescales. Going farther back, we see this interesting relationship, correlation at least, between temperature and CO2 levels, and this takes us back about 400,000 years. We now, actually there are some that go back 800,000 years, and they show the rising and falling of temperature, which is the blue line, and the red being carbon dioxide, and you can see on this graph clearly that the increase recently is virtually a vertical increase on geological timescales. And as I alluded to earlier, climate modelers have done much more detailed models than Arrhenius did and have a range of temperature increase that's likely with a doubling of CO2, not that different from what was known in the 1890s. So there's reason to think that the planet might be heating up with CO2 rising. Is it? And in order to get a better answer to that, we have to look at not just the air, but the land surfaces and also the ocean. When we look at one part of land, which is ice, clearly recently there's been a decrease in Arctic ice. And in fact, in the summer of 2010, there were a couple ships that managed to make the Northwest Passage and actually circumnavigate the pole in the summer. This hasn't been possible until recently. And it's likely, if this trend continues, that we will see an ice-free Arctic at the end of the summer in another 15 years or so. Hard to predict because there is some fluctuation, but the trend is clear that ice is diminishing. This is another chart that shows the seasonal ice extent, and you can see it's lowest in September and then builds up again. But the gray shaded area shows the range of values that existed prior to about 10 years ago. And the colored lines show you what we've seen more recently. So it's beyond the range that we expected until about 10 years ago. Going back farther in time, it becomes more uncertain, but there are ways of gauging temperature, estimating temperature, and it shows that the most recent period, yes, is warmer. However, this chart is often brought forward recently. We've got a few contrarians around, some who are surprisingly well-credentialed, who still say things like, global warming stopped 12 years ago, look at the chart. Well, if you look at this chart, you do see a flattening in air temperatures over the last 10 years. It's not without precedent that there would be that there are dips and pauses, but we do see that the last 10 years have been somewhat different. So what about this? No, other direction, thanks. What about this? Well, wait a minute, what are we not looking at here? We're talking about the Earth, and if we look at the Earth from a distance, what we see is water. We don't so much see air, and maybe it should be called planet ocean or planet water. The ocean, in fact, holds about 1,000 times as much heat, has about 1,000 times as much heat capacity as the air. What about the ocean? Let's take a closer look at it. If you go back one slide, okay? If you plunged into the planet's sphere from outer space, you might land here, okay? But you more likely would land here. Most of the planet's surface is ocean. And so we really have to look at what's going on with the ocean if we're going to look at what's going on with climate change. Interestingly, in the last 8 or 9 years, a whole new effort has been undertaken to get a better picture of the ocean. And this is the system of Argo floats that are now deployed all around the world. This is a Argo float being launched, and it will go into the ocean, and it will sink to about 1,000 meters. Here's what they look like in cross-section. They have a bladder at the bottom that's inflated and deflated, changing the buoyancy of the float, and they're designed to sit at 1,000 meters for 10 days, and then to change their density and dive to 2,000 feet, and then they change their density again and come all the way up to the surface and transmit their data via satellite. These are collecting data on ocean temperature, salinity, currents, directions of currents, and they've collected more data in the last 8 or 9 years than we've collected throughout the 20th century on these parameters of the ocean. This is the network of them. There's about 3,000 of them now. And they are collecting some amazing data in terms of its quantity and depth, really. We haven't been able to get that understanding of the ocean until very recently. And this is what we see when we look at the temperature of the ocean. This is between a surface and 2,000 meters, which is still only about half of the ocean. Ocean is huge and deep, but when we look at the top 2,000 meters, we definitely see no slowdown in global warming. Absolutely no slowdown. Again, interestingly, there are fluctuations. We'll get back to that. But if you look at kind of a little chart here showing how much of the estimated warming of the Earth has been taken up by the oceans versus other media, this is what you see. The air is just a very small part of it. So we have to consider the ocean when we're looking at climate change. And this is another picture that shows some of the similar perspective. So what can we expect? Will this summer be hotter than next? What about next summer? Why did we have such a cold winter? Well, James Hansen, a famous climate scientist, has likened the climate to the variations to what you would expect if you rolled a die. And consider that you have a die that has a red, two red sides, two white sides, two blue sides. The blue sides represent normal year. The red sides represent a warmer than normal year, and the white sides represent a colder than normal. Well, let's make the white be average and the blue colder. Okay, but you toss that die, and the odds are that you know, it'll be even chance that it'll be colder, warmer, or average. What Hansen says is that we're, his analogy is, what we're doing is basically loading the die so that there are, instead of one red side, there's two or even three red sides. There's still a blue side, there's still a white side. So you toss the die, you still could have a colder than average year. You could have an average year, but it's more likely that you'll have a warmer than average year. So what can we expect? Well, these fluctuations will continue, it's virtually certain, but long term, all media will heat up. And as the recent report of the Association for the Advancement of Science says, there is the risk of abrupt, unpredictable changes. There could be some climate dragons out there that we don't know about. But we still can't make really good predictions at a regional or local level, especially, without better understanding the climate of the ocean. And there is some good data that the recent slowdown in atmospheric warming is strongly related to changes in the ocean circulation. Everyone trying to get a better understanding of this. It's clear, though, that when we look at temperature records, we see a lot of variation. This is the average temperature in New Jersey. It's been tracked for 100 years, and the line represents the trend, and it's clearly warmer. But notice how much variation there is from year to year. We can still have a very cold winter and a cold average year. And we can have a warmer, and there's just a lot of variation from year to year, and we also see that in winter temperatures. So the variation is one of the things that tends to throw people off, and that's not going to go away. Things might become more variable. This is a chart that was put together by Hansen and co-workers. And what they did was look at 250-kilometer grids throughout the planet and took the average summertime temperature of each of those grids and determined whether it was warmer than average in a particular year or not, and graph the distribution. So the red line shows what it looked like in the 50s. All these 250 by 250 kilometer grids, which is about the size of New Jersey and eastern Pennsylvania. Okay, these are fairly good sized regions. In the period of the 50s, a certain percentage of those were had a colder than normal year, and a certain percentage had a warmer than normal year, and the distribution was that familiar bell-shaped curve where you have most of the grids had an average year, and the distribution looks like that red line. And then they did the same thing for every decade since then, and what we see here is, yes, the average temperature is warming. The peak of each distribution is moving to the right, and it's also broadening. So we're getting more variation from year to year, as well as warmer. And the purple line, the 2050 line, was done by a fellow named Stuart Staniford, who's a computer scientist at Cornell now. And he did that chart, which was basically taking the rate of change of these distributions and moving it forward. And it looks very consistent with the other ones. And what it suggests is that by 2050, we still could have a colder than normal year, but we're likely to have some really hot years as well. But it's still a lot depends on what the ocean does. And the ocean is that old trickster, the ocean. What is it really up to? In the last couple of decades, the term El Nino and La Nina have started to become part of our vocabularies, and they represent periodic pulses of heat energy from the ocean that seems to follow a cycle. There's also a cycle in the North Atlantic. And these have tremendous ability to influence weather on land. And we're just beginning to get a better understanding of those. But some changes are virtually certain. And one of these is that seas will rise. And this is a chart of Atlantic City, where we have good data going back into the almost 1900. It's again marked by year-to-year fluctuations, but the overall trend is clearly up. The sea is rising at Atlantic City at about 4 millimeters a year, and it's a little higher there than many places on the planet because the land is also sinking a little bit at Atlantic City. But when we look at the global picture, it's a similar picture. And this is one of the most inarguable pieces of evidence that the planet is warming. The seas rise for only two reasons at a global level: melting of land-based ice and thermal expansion of the water of the ocean. And we can expect this to continue, and there are those who predict that it will accelerate. Why might it accelerate? Let's go back a little bit before I get to that. And this is a longer-term record that's based on sediment cores. Looking at sediments, one can tell where the coast was and infer the level of the ocean from that. And when that's been done, this was done by Ben Horton and colleagues. At the time, he was at U of Penn. I'm not sure if he's still there. It shows again that sea level rise has accelerated in the last 100 years. What could change the rate of sea level rise? What could make it accelerate more? Well, melting of ice could do it. Melting of ocean ice really won't do it. If think about a glass of water with ice cubes in it, when the ice cubes melt, the water doesn't overflow the glass. But because ice is a different density from water, but ice on land, when that melts, yes, it raises sea level. And we are starting to see what looks like an acceleration of melting of ice on Greenland. This is a picture of Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets combined. This shows the ice sheet mass balance based on gravimetric records from satellites. And notice the units here. When I first saw this, I thought, well, that's it's a linear line. I mean, okay, it's melting, but that rate, it's going to take a long time before anything would happen. But notice it's not per year, it's per year per year. Maybe you could go back to that. One more back. There we go. This is gigatons per year squared. So every year, the trend is 36 more gigatons melted than the year before. And this has been the case over the last 12 years or so. So in other words, year one, let's say 1992, 36 gigatons melted. Year two, 72 gigatons melted. And year three, 36 gigatons more. So it's not a linear curve at all. It's a curve that if you fit a line to it, it starts to look like this. And I thought, well, okay, that's interesting. Let's see how long, what would happen if that trend continues. How long would it be before the ice caps really start to melt? And it's easy enough to do something like that. This is for Antarctica. And it's easy enough to kind of speculate what would happen. And this is just a little graph drawn by a spreadsheet program that takes that 36 gigatons and adds it to each year's loss. And you don't see much change for 40 or 50 years because there's so much ice on these continents. But 100 years from now, all hell could be breaking loose in terms of sea level rise. Because if that trend continues, we could see half a meter every few decades, perhaps. This is speculative, but that's what we would see if what appear to be the current trends continue. So what's the cause of this? Well, there's several questions that anyone who really thinks that it's not caused by greenhouse gas emissions have trouble answering. And one of them is, okay, if CO2 and other greenhouse gases aren't causing the heating, what is? And the second question is, the first question is, if they're not causing the heating, why not? Because we know that they absorb infrared. You can measure that in the laboratory. If they're not causing the heating, why aren't they? And if it's not them that's causing it, what is? Well, there have been various things that have been suggested, but they don't hold up. If you look at the variations in the sun, volcanoes, et cetera, nothing much explains it except the rise in CO2 and other greenhouse gases. So natural influences and things like volcanoes, which are natural but sporadic, can't explain it. Models based on the sorts of calculations that our Arrhenius did in the 1890s, carried forward with our wonderful computer capacity, do explain it. And these same models predict that it's going to get warmer still. And this is just a chart showing models versus natural forcings, which are things like the sun, solar cycles, and only human forcings, greenhouse gases. And the two together explain the recent history quite well. So what are the likely effects? Well, certainly, and this Leslie mentioned the climate assessment just came out. We're probably seeing some of these already, but the effects would be more extreme weather. And that would include very hot episodes, that would include droughts, heavy rains, floods, possibly more intense storms, coastal erosion. Coastal states like we are need to really be cognizant of that, and ecological effects as well. Moscow in 2010 had a terrible heat episode, and this picture, they're also trying to protect themselves from smoke from wildfires, which were raging in the region. We've had our share of those as well, and they're certainly correlated with this, which is drought. We've been enduring a terrible drought in the Southwest and in California, not inconsistent with climate change predictions. Rainfall, interestingly, that warm air can hold more moisture, and the data are now clear that rain events are becoming more intense on average. It varies by region. Some regions are getting drier, but many regions are experiencing more rain, and the rain is coming in more intense bursts. We've all sort of, those of us that follow baseball would probably appreciate the analogy between the steroid era, and players hitting home runs, long home runs. You can't point to any particular home run and say that was caused by steroids. But you can look at the whole picture and say, you know, there's probably an effect there. The same thing may be the case with floods. And this one, next one. I like to go see the river, and it's pretty scary when it looks like this. And we've had 6 or 7 50-year floods in the last 15 years. You can't say for sure that it's due to climate change, but it's consistent with the trends. This is a chart that was put together by Kerry Emanuel, who was a skeptic about hurricanes for a while, but he put together what's called the power dissipation index, and that's the function of how big a hurricane is geographically, how long it lasts, and how high, what the speed of its winds are. And when you look at the trend of North Atlantic cyclones, you see this trend, which does show that they're becoming stronger. We don't see that for much of the rest of the world. So this is still a little bit of a puzzle. But there recently was a study. One of the problems with these sorts of studies is that farther back you go in time, the worse the data gets. And the authors of this most recent study compensated for that by actually detuning the more recent data so that it was consistent with the older data. And they looked at the strength of hurricanes throughout the world, and they do see significantly statistic trend. It's those of you that are into statistics, it's significant at the 90% level that there's an upward trend. For the North Atlantic, it's clearly significant. So there may be some reasons for that, and that goes back to our noting that the oceans are so important and so poorly understood. Coastal erosion. This is Long Beach Island, and you can see the orange sand has been brought in. The whiter colored sand was what was there originally. And you can see that a lot of the recently brought in sand has eroded. When I was a boy, we used to go to Ocean City, and the ocean was under the boardwalk. And it's not that way now. And beach replenishment has worked. It's been something that has pushed back the ocean in New Jersey, and you can go to Ocean City today, and it's a nice big beach. But that comes at a cost. That is done by pumping sand, either from the bays or from deeper in the ocean, bringing it up onto the coast, and it erodes maybe about 7% per year of that newly deposited sand erodes. And when you look at a chart of, and the data on this are a little hard to come by, and I haven't updated it, but when you look at the amount of sand deposited on New Jersey's beaches, you see what arguably is an unsustainable trend. How long can we keep holding back the rising ocean by pumping sand, especially if federal funds, which have funded most of it, start to dry up? Other changes. The ocean's pH has changed from 8.2, which it was for several million years at least, it's changed to 8.1 in the last 300 years. That doesn't sound like much, except pH is a logarithmic scale. So 8.1 means there's 30% more hydrogen ions in the ocean today than there was 300 years ago. And that probably will cause problems for coral and other creatures that take calcium out of the water to build their structures. Calcium is harder to come by when the pH drops. Another change that we see around us, vines. Vines are going crazy. Has anybody else noticed that? Yeah. Poison ivy has become invasive. It's a native, okay? Native plants aren't supposed to be invasive, but poison ivy is not the same as it was because it's living in an atmosphere that has 40% more carbon than it had for millions and millions of years. And carbon is, it's not a food, but it's a feedstock for plants, as my friend Jonathan pointed out to me. It was you that made that point, and it was a good one. Plants' food is the sun, but they use carbon dioxide as a nutrient, for sure. And vines seem to benefit. There's several studies on this. Vines benefit more than trees from extra CO2 because they don't have to build structures. The more CO2, the faster they grow, the more leaves they have, the more CO2, the more faster they grow. It's kind of a positive feedback. And so vines are becoming more of a problem. And that's another ecological effect. So what can we do about it? Well, number one, admit there's a problem. Two, figure out how we can adapt to it, because even if we could cut our greenhouse gas emissions immediately, there's a lot of change that's baked into the system that will unfold as time goes on. So we're going to have to figure out how to adapt to this. And oh, wait a minute. Sorry, Nick. We probably should consider geoengineering, but our humans' attempts to rectify things in the past haven't always worked so well. So let's take a real close look at geoengineering. There's various schemes. One would be to inject sulfate aerosols into the upper atmosphere, which would reflect light, cool the planet. There's actually a proposal to build a space station and put it partway between the Earth and the Sun that would unfold and to be a kind of a great big pair of sunglasses, kind of, or a mirror that would block sun. Let's look real closely at these before we consider deploying them, and let's try to keep things from getting worse by cutting our greenhouse gas emissions as rapidly as we can. And that means things at the personal scale, but it also means large-scale actions. Ways to adapt. Okay, prepare for floods, prepare for heat stress. There's certainly things that can be done to alleviate heat stress, which is particularly hard on the elderly and children. Prepare for drought. Drought is arguably more scary than floods. They both obviously can be intensely problematic, but how are we going to deal with drought? Well, one thing, this township, Hopewell Township, has a drought ordinance, and basically it says it has a series of criteria that the township can use when it looks like a drought is coming on. There's a series of steps, and the first one is encourage people not to irrigate their lawns, don't allow filling of swimming pools, but allow swimming pools to be topped off. And the measures get more stringent the more serious the drought is. And so the township is ready to restrict water use if need be. And that's an example of the kinds of things that we can do to prepare for drought. And also, we need to find better ways to manage the coasts. This is an example of the kind of things that we do to look at effects of floods. Where are areas that are going to be especially prone to flooding? Where are the bridges, the underpasses that won't be passable? Where is the infrastructure that's most at risk? We need to seriously start doing this on a full tilt basis. And then ways to cut greenhouse gas emissions. There are a lot of things. The average building, it is said, can cut its energy use 30% using existing technology that has a payback of 7 years or less. This would be things like installing a more efficient heater, if one's heater is not efficient, changing out light bulbs, insulating better, eliminating leaks of warm air and leaks of cold air in the summer. And we also need to use and promote low and no carbon energy. And interestingly, eating less meat also lowers one's carbon footprint, because particularly the way we raise meat in this country is very energy intensive. Energy conservation holds a lot of promise. All you have to do is look at the yearly energy use of this country, and this is a picture from the EIA. And the gray and the darker gray, the charcoal gray, is the energy that's actually put to use, and the lighter gray is wasted energy. And we waste more energy than we use, and that's because our technology is inefficient to that degree. A gasoline engine is only about, at best, 25% efficient. So there's lots of ground that can be gained in those areas. We need renewables and low carbon and no carbon alternatives. And this is a coal burning power plant. This is in Montour, Pennsylvania. And they're very proud of this recent improvements to this plant. It is much cleaner. It's now controls its sulfur emissions, but it's not clean coal in the sense of carbon dioxide. It's still putting out plenty of that. Wind and photovoltaics we know about. And there's another source that, let's not forget, nuclear. Right now we're getting probably half our energy in this room is electrons probably came from this plant. This is in South Jersey, and it just pumps out the electricity day after day. Recently, there's been some talk about taking a fresh look at nuclear. There's a movie that I highly recommend. You can get it on Netflix, elsewhere. It's called Pandora's Promise, okay? Pandora's Promise, I saw it at the Princeton Film Festival, and it's an excellent documentary. It's got some former anti-nuclear people who have now said, or now saying, let's take a fresh look at nuclear in light of third and fourth generation, in light of increasing data that suggests that low levels of radiation in fact are not that harmful. We are exposed to radiation all the time. Let's take a fresh look at nuclear. Globally, we have to cut our emissions by half to stabilize CO2. And we're not getting close to that with what we've done so far. So, and this is just a chart that shows global greenhouse gas emissions. There's no perceptible result of Kyoto and all the other things that have been talked about. The effort to increase the pace of renewables is, yes, we have many more solar panels than we did, but in a sense, those just make what fossil fuel remains cheaper. So we haven't cut our emissions of CO2 and other greenhouse gases significantly. And this is why I'm more optimistic than I used to be. It is clear to me that bipartisan support is building for a carbon tax. And I had the pleasure of getting involved with a group a year or so ago that's working for a carbon tax. It used to be that when you mentioned the T word, people turned off. Don't even talk about a carbon tax. But in fact, it makes a lot of sense compared to other approaches. It's more economically efficient than cap and trade, than command and control, than subsidies, all of which have their cost. We tend to think of subsidies as being not costing anything, but they do. The carbon tax seems, and many economists say this, is more efficient way of putting a price on carbon than other things that have been tried. It wouldn't interfere as much with other programs, easier to administer. One thing governments throughout the world can do is collect taxes. And there, it wouldn't be hard to modify our existing apparatus to collect a carbon tax. It would have a broad-based effect because we use fossil fuels in so many ways. The way a carbon tax would work is that the price would be put on carbon at the point where it entered the economy. And it would be more amenable also, this is one of its, in my view, one of the prime selling points, is that it would not, it would, if the U.S., let's say, had a carbon tax, that would make our manufactured goods more expensive, and that might put us at a disadvantage to another country that didn't have a carbon tax. But it looks as if, and this is based on analysis by lawyers, so I have to sort of take their word for it, but it looks like international agreements such as GATT and the World Trade Organization agreements would allow a border tax on goods from a country that didn't have a carbon tax. So that would make that country have an incentive to put a tax itself on carbon. And in fact, China is apparently looking seriously at a carbon tax. So it looks like it could be better from an international perspective. And last but not least, it could be revenue neutral. And this would get rid of the regressive argument. Any tax can be regressive, but if the money that was collected was returned to households, then it would be revenue neutral. And this is a group that Citizens Climate Lobby that I'm proud to be part of. This was last summer when we met with representatives in Washington. And Citizens Climate Lobby is working for a revenue neutral carbon tax. Look at that phrase, revenue neutral carbon tax. There's something in that to offend both Democrats and Republicans. Democrats, the argument's going to have to be, look, let's make it revenue neutral. Let's not say, okay, now we've got this great new source of money, we can fund all these programs that need to be funded. That's not revenue neutral. To the Republicans, you say, look, it's revenue neutral, so it's not really a tax in the same sense that other taxes have been. And yes, it is putting a price on carbon, and some of the biggest industries are carbon intensive, so yes, there will be a cost. So there's something for neither party to be wholly enthusiastic about it, but on the other hand, there's something for each end of the political spectrum to be okay about it. So that's why it seems to have some bipartisan appeal. So I'm optimistic because it seems inevitable to me that we will enact a carbon tax at some point. And this is some resources. I guess I'll just leave those up there. They're part of the presentation. You can get more info on climate issues and on carbon tax. There's a couple good websites, Carbon Tax Center and Citizens Climate Lobby itself. And then Pandora's Promise, again, it's worth watching if you are interested in taking a fresh look at nuclear. That's where I'll stop. Okay.